Welcome to Art Appreciation. This is Chapter 8, and we're talking about prints today as our next medium for art. In this chapter, we're going to talk about relief processes, and if you don't know what that means, we will discuss that. Intaglio, lithography, screen printing, monotype, and inkjet. So there's several processes in making prints that you may not be familiar with. And so I'm sure everyone will learn today some things they didn't know before about the printmaking process. Some key terms that you will pick up as we go through the chapter are matrix, addition, registration, key block, burin, ground, planographic process, touche, and photogravé. So let's jump right in with our first slide. What are prints? Have you ever walked through some mud and then tracked that into a building, your house or a store or something, and you're walking across the floor and realize, oops, I am leaving dirty footprints everywhere I go? What you have done is made a print. That is the general idea of printmaking, is that where there's a raised surface, like the tread on the bottom of your shoe with some mud on it, and then you stepped and you made a print of that raised part of your shoe that had mud on it. So you can see here on the right hand side of your screen some of the different types of print making that we're going to talk about, but it's all very similar and all has that in common, that you are taking ink or you're taking some sort of printing medium and you are putting it onto a piece of paper through the process of printing. With printmaking, the artist uses a matrix. So your shoe, the bottom of your shoe, would be the matrix in that little scenario I described. That's the surface on which a design is prepared to begin the process. This surface is inked and then transferred to another material. Multiples can be made from this indirect process. That's in italics because it's really important. You want to get down what I basically had on this slide about what a matrix is and what printmaking is, but you want to make sure you understand that. With printmaking, it's different than painting, it's different than drawing, and this is one of the big reasons why. You can make multiples off of the same matrix. Just like when you take your shoe and step in mud, you can make multiple footprints of that same tread on the bottom of your shoe. You can do that with printmaking. So it creates a whole different world of possibility. Because when you make a painting with oil paint, like we learned about last chapter, there's only one. There's only one of those. Of course, we can make prints through photography now and multiple images, but there is only one original, right? With printmaking, it's kind of cool because you can actually make multiple originals. And we call this an indirect process because you're not taking the paper and drawing on the paper, are you? Or making an ink image on the paper directly. It goes through these steps and it becomes an indirect process. You make the matrix, you make the thing, like your shoe, and treat it and do different things to it like we're going to learn about today, but then the ink is pressed onto that and then onto the paper. So hopefully, and if you don't have all this written down here, that's okay, because we're going to go through those processes. This is just to give you a visual of like the side and the main types of printmaking. We have relief printmaking, where whatever's left raised, the ink is going to get onto it. Intaglio, the general idea is whatever is incised or carved out of the matrix, the ink is going to settle down into those crevices, and you actually wipe away the top, but the ink on the in the little divots is where you'll get the marking made when you print it on paper. When you do intaglio printing, you have to smash it really, really hard to get the ink to kind of squish up out of those little crevices. And we'll talk about how that's done in a bit. Lithography is a whole different thing. It's a really unique printmaking process, which, again, we will look at in more detail. But basically, the image, like this apple, is held on by ink, and because it's been treated in a special way that makes the ink stick to it, All the rest of this, what we call the negative space or the ground, right? This is the positive or the figure. This is the negative space, the ground. That will resist the ink through a treatment of the lithography stone. So you'll see that in a bit too. So it's a really different way than the other. And then screen printing is very unique and different too. It might be one that people are actually more familiar with because t-shirts and signs and things like that are still printed through this screen printing process. Basically, you have a screen, you use some sort of wax or blocker that blocks everything out, and what's left unblocked, you squeegee the ink across there and it comes through onto the paper or shirt or whatever you're printing on. Okay, so we're going to look at more than just those four, but those are the four general categories. A couple of vocabulary words. What is an addition? An addition is the total number of prints made from a plate or block, which again is called the matrix. So an example would be 6 out of 100. The 100 means there are 100 total number of prints made, and you would number if you printed 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. When you get to the sixth print, you would number it. You would write 6/100. That means there are a total of 100, and this is the sixth one. Registration is precise alignment of impressions made by two or more printing blocks. It allows for multiple colors to be developed within an addition. So again, the addition is the total number, right? And an artist, a printmaking artist, will actually plan that before they start printing. Otherwise, you don't know what number to write on each one. But usually they will say, okay, I'm going to make 20 additions. And then you number them as you work through. But if you have registration, that means you're going to do more than, you're going to have multiple printing blocks because they're going to have different shapes of color that will fit together to make that. And that'll make more sense as we go through. I know that probably doesn't make a whole lot of sense right now because you haven't seen the processes very much. But just know that a registration means that you have to align your blocks and you can do multiple colors that way. Oops. Oh my goodness. I'm flipping around. Okay. So with relief printmaking, that's our first main type. I'm going to show you three different kinds of relief printmaking. The general definition of relief printmaking includes any method in which the image to be printed is raised from the background, just like I showed you in that side picture at the first slide. The ink sits on top, like the tread of your shoe. It's the part that's raised. And this is our first type that I'm going to show you of relief printmaking. This is an example of a woodcut. The image is drawn on a block of wood. Non-image areas, in other words, the negative space, right? Those areas are carved away following the wood grain. It doesn't always, like as you can see in this one, it kind of goes different directions, but for ease of doing it, artists try to do it with the wood grain because it's just very difficult to cut against the wood grain. The remaining raised block areas are inked. So if you look closely at this flower picture, you can see all the divots where it's been carved away. And look at the extreme detail. So where, like within, I'm going to draw on here real quick. Like in here, where you see these little white V-shaped things and anywhere where you see white, like even these white lines through there, that has all been carved with a very fine tip tool. So as you can see how big this finger is of this person, that is tiny, tiny details that have been taken out, little bitty cuts wherever it's cut away, even these tiny little things right here where it's been cut away, that will not print. What's left raised, the black that you see has been left raised, that will pick up ink when they ink it and print it. The next type of relief, now please understand this is under the main heading of relief sculpture. These are all relief. What's raised, what's left raised gets printed. This is an example of a lino cut, they're called. It's made on linoleum. Now there's a special type of linoleum they make for this printmaking. It's not usually just what you go get off the floor for linoleum. But it's the same idea. If you've felt linoleum, you know it's kind of squishy, kind of soft. It's got like a thickness to it. And the reason linoleum is so good to cut is you can go different directions. You don't have to worry about the grain of the wood. You also, it's nice because it's softer. It's easier to cut. As you can imagine, cutting wood with a little blade for this extreme detail is difficult. It's not super easy to do. And so this one, same thing. Everywhere in these little scenes that you're seeing, the title of this one is Men Are Working in Town. You can see it's almost like set up like a comic strip where there's three different scenarios of story happening. But everywhere that's left black is where they have not cut anything away. And then everywhere that is white is where it's been cut away. So sometimes there's big white areas like these houses here. That's a large white area. All that's been cut away. You can see a little bit gets picked up with the roller when they do the print. This big cow here, all that's just been left black to be raised. But look at all of the texture. Notice that word of art, an art element, right? Texture. And how is the texture created? Through repetition of lines. So we're using lots of art vocabulary there. Repetition of lines creates texture in these. And there's different ones, like this lady's hair. Little marks make it look textury. Little marks on the roof of this hut make it look textury. And sometimes it's just lines that make it look that way. But that's a good analysis of that. And then look at these where you had to cut out the white all around those black dots. That would be tricky, but the entire thing is that you can make sense of it as black and white. Now these kind of images that are black and white can be evaluated as well in another art word we've talked about, which is balance. Do you think when you look at this, there's a balance between the white and the black space? In some places, there's big areas of black, like that cow. Some places, there's big areas of white, like the houses or the tabletop. And there's lots of in-between. There's lots of textury places. But what do you think? Do you think that the black and the white feels balanced? And why does it? If it feels balanced, why does it? You can also talk about these interestingly in thinking about positive and negative space or figure and ground. Do you feel like the figure, meaning the thing that the artist is drawing, and the ground, meaning the background, are kind of mushed together in these? Like they are almost like one thing. Do you see that? Or do you see it that way or a different way? You can see it in a different way if you, it's up to you. But look at how, I'll do this again. Do you see these lines back here? That's clearly representing the background in some way. But it almost is part of the regular space too. Like it's every inch of this thing is used and just lots and lots of detail and space being used, either positive or negative. Sometimes it's hard to tell. Is it positive or negative space? Like right here looks like the sky, but then you get over here and you're like, oh, never mind, that's a cow. So the negative space is still part of the positive space in that case. So being able to look at art and analyze it using that vocabulary that we've talked about, balance and texture, positive and negative space, figure and ground, all of those things come into play when we analyze art. Repetition, look at this, repeating. repeating those heads. Do you feel any rhythm in this when you look at it? Is there maybe a sense of rhythm as you go through it? Sometimes even just having 1, 2, 3 can make a sense of rhythm. The repetition of these spaces that they've made. But definitely like the repetition of the lines. Lots of line repetition in this. Okay, just using that as a little example for us to analyze a work of art. And the third type of relief method is called wood engraving. So this is using wood again, but do you remember I said that it's hard to carve into wood when it has such a strong grain in it? Like, you know, the wood particles, they kind of go one direction. So when you're trying to cut against those or into those, like perpendicular, it's very difficult. Like, it wants to splinter and chunks want to come off. But with wood engraving, you actually use the end of the block of wood. So picture like a big fat stump of a tree. And instead of using the side of the stump of the tree, you use the cross section of it. And you would just like sand that down so it's perfectly smooth. Like sand. It felt really, really, really smooth. And then you would work on the end of the block of wood. And that allows you to carve in any direction. In fact, I'm not so sure after careful looking that this is not, I'm not so sure that this is not actually a wood engraving because of the way he so easily went different directions. It's a little hard to tell, but oftentimes with true woodcut, the artist makes a lot of effort to just cut one direction because of the grain of the wood. So let's look at an example. This is actually a wood engraving. It's a different kind of example, but it does show you a little bit more ease at which that person was able to carve away. Again, anything that's white, or in this case tan, the paper's kind of tan, has been cut away. Anything that's black is left behind. So because you can cut any direction with a lino cut or a wood engraving, you can see that it's easier to go different directions. There can be lots of diagonals. There can be marks going all directions, little cuts going all directions versus just sticking to one way. So this says Skeletons as Artisans is the title of this one, 1890 to 1910. They're making shoes and cutting wood and sewing things, painting back here. I don't see anybody making pottery. But that's an example of a wood engraving. Now, I'm going to show you, I'm going to click over and show you on this website. This is the Met, Metropolitan Museum of Art. And I want to just click through this. What is printmaking? And this picture is pretty cool because it shows you lots of different media materials that are used in printmaking. So I'm just going to scroll through here. And we're going to look at some of these different types that gives you more examples. So the first one we talked about was a, actually they don't have, relief sculpture. They call it a woodcut. Okay, so woodcut. They're calling it woodcut, which is also relief. Same thing. And here's what you would use for a woodcut. You have a block of wood, and as you can see, this is not the end of it. This is the side of it, so you definitely have some grain in there. These are what the cutting tools look like. This is a V gouge. This is a knife gouge. There's a little, I don't see a scoop gouge, but that one might be a scoop gouge. And then here's the black ink that you use. It's very, very thick black ink. and you use these brayers to, they don't have a rolling pad in here, but you would use a rolling pad, roll the ink onto the brayer real evenly, and then roll over your block once it's cut. The oldest form of printmaking, woodcut, is a relief process in which knives and other tools are used to carve a design on the surface of a wood block. The raised areas remain after the block has been cut and are inked and printed, while the recessed areas that are cut away do not retain ink, as we've talked about. I'm going to go on down here. So here she is drawing. The design is drawn or sketched onto a piece of paper, as you can see. She flipped it over and she's coloring in the backside with a pencil. So there's different ways to transfer your image over, but this is one of the most simple and basic ways to do it. So again, first step, she drew the image, then she colored the back of the image with graphite, laid it on top of the wood, and traced over it, and it made that graphite impression onto her block of wood. Right there, she's pressing, and there's the image, and then she went over it with marker so she could see it more easily. Wood blocks are most often cut by a professional block cutter who uses a chisel, gouge, or knife to carefully cut away sections of the block that will not receive ink. So as you can see, she is cutting away all of what she doesn't want to be printed. And in this case, this person looks like she's using a very soft wood. So it's even though you can see the grain in it, she is able to cut both directions pretty good. She's only going to leave those white lines raised. Everything else is going to get cut away. Oh, I said white lines. I meant blue. But it looks like she did leave the entire white circly things. Okay, the lines that comprise the image then stand in relief to the rest of the block, which is why woodcuts are in groups of printmaking techniques called relief prints, like we've talked about. So here's what the block looks like after she's done all the cutting. She put lots of texture at the top and then those sort of rocky shapes. She's cut all around them. So they're going to pick up ink, but the negative space around them is not going to pick up ink. The block is then inked evenly by using a dauber or ink ball or a roller, taking care not to spill ink into the recesses because you want the ink just to sit on top of the texture. Now, in printmaking, you're going to see there's a little bit that gets on some of those raised places, just a little bit. And most people, that's just how it looks. And that's kind of cool because it shows the process that it was. But you want to get that real evenly when you roll your ink across it. The block is then placed on the bed of a press, and a sheet of dampened paper is placed into the ink surface of the block. So you dampen the paper, you put it over the block. And then you're going to put it, printmakers can either use a platen press roller, platen press or a roller press. Although some earlier relief prints appear to have been produced by simply pressing the paper against the block with one's hand. The use of a press is preferable for the consistent distribution of ink. And from my experience in printmaking, the some that I have done, it's so much better to roll it through a printing press like this one that you see, which is why I wanted to show you this so you can see what a real one looks like. In, you know, elementary classes or something, we do printmaking, but you can just use like the back of a spoon and burnish the back of it, press really, really hard. It's never going to be as good of a print as like a professional big print roller like this, but yet it's the same effect and it still looks good. Once printed onto its paper support, the woodcut's design appears in reverse of the original on the block. And you can see that very clearly. Something to note is as I said, printmaking is repeatable. So you would actually be able to make, she could make as many prints of that woodblock as she wants to. Eventually, it might start to fail. It might start to get cracked or broken or something, but most of the time you can make many, many prints off of the same wood block. And do you remember what that's called when you choose to make a certain amount of prints off of one matrix? It's called addition. However many you're making is how many is in that addition. And so this one might be, she's only made one here, so maybe she's going to make five in this addition. So she would write 1/5 would be the technical way to do that. All right, back to our PowerPoint. We're going to go to the next type of printmaking method, and that's called intaglio. Intaglio is an Italian word that means to cut. It is the reverse of relief. The area meant to be printed is below the surface of the printing plate. So if you remember back, on the first slide, it showed you a side view. This is a different grouping. These are all the different types of intaglio that there are. But from the side, you can see relief printing is on top. Intaglio is the part that goes down into the matrix. And we have these different types: engraving, dry point, mezzotint, etching, and aquatint. And I will go through those quickly, but I think in this case, I'll go ahead and go back to the Met, and we'll talk about etching. So etching is intaglio, what we just said. Etching is an intaglio printmaking process. So it's the broad category, think of it this way, the big overarching category is intaglio, which means that the ink is going below the surface of the matrix. It's going down into the lines. Etching is one type. And so, they're all very similar. So if you see this one played out, you'll understand the other ones better too. So the lines or areas are incised using acid into a metal plate in order to hold the ink. In etching, the plate can be made of iron, copper, or zinc. So this is a very laborious technique. Etching is an intaglio printmaking process. Sorry about that. To prepare the plate for etching, it is first polished to remove all scratches and imperfections from the surface. When the surface is completely smooth, it is covered evenly with a layer of acid-resistant varnish or wax, which is also called the ground. So this is tying back in to like what we talked about with painting. There's that word again, ground. It's like applying some sort of primer or surface to prep it, to get it ready for what we're going to do. So that black stuff is the ground, or the varnish, which we call the ground. And that person has covered the entire very smooth metal plate with the ground. Now, what do we do next? We're using a burnt stylus called an etching needle. The printmaker gently scratches away parts of the ground. So you're gently scratching away parts of that black stuff, which is like wax, a coating that stays on. And so when you do that, and you're following a design, when you do that, you expose the metal beneath. See how it looks like the metal again where he's scratching it away? Once the entire design has been drawn into the ground, acid is poured over the plate, or the plate is dipped into acid. So in this one, he's just putting it in an acid bath. The acid eats into the metal only in the exposed areas, creating recesses that can retain ink. So if you can picture that from the side, that wherever there's not that black stuff, the acid just eats down into the metal, and it just eats it away and makes a bigger and bigger divot the longer you leave it in there. So the depth and the width of these recesses is determined by the length of time the plate is exposed to the acid. A longer exposure will cause deeper and wider recesses, which hold more ink. And think about it in your brain. What does that mean? It's going to print darker lines on the paper because it's more ink, a little bit wider, a little bit deeper. More ink. So this process can be used to create a nuanced tonal palette. If you want darker tones, you may have to bathe it several times in the acid. If you want little fine, thin lines to show, then after you've done this acid bath, you'll want to cover those places up with more of the ground to protect it. But other places you want to be really deep and dark, you could keep bathing it back into the acid. Once the plate has been satisfactorily bitten by the acid, the printmaker removes the ground with a solvent. So now, do you see what he's doing? Wearing protective gloves, obviously, and pouring that stuff on there. I'm not sure what it is, if it's turpentine or mineral spirits or something. I think it was mineral spirits. And he wiped it away. So that does remove the ground. Or it might have been... it actually might be, I can't think of the word, some other kind of remover. After the ground is removed, the plate is ready for inking. And in an intaglio process, the ink is retained in the incised lines. Can you picture that in your mind? These places that go down deep, the ink is going to stay in those places. So watch what he's doing. He's smearing the ink, like using a little squeegee thing to smush the ink down into all those little crevices. Smush. Then he takes a cloth and he wipes it away. But he can't wipe away what's down in the incised lines. It stays down in there. A cloth ball, cardboard tab, or equivalent material is used to gently spread ink across the whole face of the plate, just like you're seeing. And then you remove the excess off with that plate. And then it's further cleaned with what would be like cheesecloth. Like it says, a heavily starched cheesecloth. You have to use a special material to get all that ink off. The last measure, as a last measure, printmakers often use the sides of their hands to wipe away the last bits of ink. In certain cases, a printmaker can choose not to clean the plate entirely, but leave a thin layer of ink on the plate to create a tone. So that's up to the printmaker. All right, now it's time for the roller. Once the surface of the plate is wiped clean to a satisfactory level, the plate is placed on the bed of a rolling printing press with the ink side up. So we'll watch what they do again. So ink side, starting at the beginning, placing the paper on top, then another piece of paper, then rolling it through the printer. Comes out, they remove the paper, and there's your print. It requires extreme pressure. It says that on this, although some earlier intaglio prints appear to have been produced by simply pressing the paper against the plate with one's hands, in most cases, the pressure required to force the paper into the finely cut lines entails the use of special press equipment with rollers. Before the plate is moved through the press, it's covered with a sheet of dampened paper. Have you noticed that's been the thing every time it's dampened paper? It just helps suck the ink out a little better when it's damp to have that moisture. And then the printing blankets, often made of felt to soften the pressure on the metal plate. And then let's see if we can look at this. Once printed onto its paper support, again, this is called a support, right? Because that's what it's been printed on. Whether painting, drawing, or printmaking, the thing you put it on is called a support. The etching's design appears in reverse of the original plate. The pressure of the press not only forces the ink into the damp paper, onto the damp paper, but also produces an outline of the outer edges of the metal plate in the paper, known as the plate mark. Does that make sense what they're talking about there? This is called the plate mark. It just does that. It makes this line across there, and it prints. Even though this has been wiped clean, it still prints kind of that grayish tone, which looks really cool. And if you could see this in person, you would see this is embossed. The paper has been smushed so hard onto that plate that it is raised where it goes up to the paper. So that is the intaglio process. And now we're going to look at some different types of intaglio. What we just looked at was etching, where you carve into the ground, and then the acid eats into those crevices. Right here is etching what we looked at. But there's several other types, so we'll look at those briefly. So generalization. With intaglio, the artist makes depressions in a metal plate using sharp tools and or acids. The plate is inked, and then the surface is wiped clean. Dampened paper is placed on the plate and run through the through a press, which transfers the ink to the paper. So that's really what we just watched the video of, just to have it in your notes. And here, we'll go into a little more detail about the different types. So engraving, and I like to have these here so you can look at these on the side and get a side perspective of what's happening. Try to understand what's happening here. With engraving, you draw with the burin, which is a large V-shaped tool used to cut lines into a metal plate. And you can see they're doing that right there. That's what that thing is right there. They're carving, they're drawing lines and cutting into it. You can do wide ones, you can do skinny ones. When they are shallow, skinny shallow, they're going to be lighter thin lines. When they are deeper cuts, they're going to be thicker, darker lines. That makes sense, right? The second one we have is dry point. You can see the side view of that one. So we have engraving right here. Now we're talking about dry point, and look at how that looks there. Similar to engraving, the cutting instrument is a dry point needle. The line is softer and less defined because when you carve into it, it has to do with the shape of the tool. The burin has a large V shape, and so it's like scooping out lines. It's like making a real crisp, clear, defined edged line. Where dry point, that's what they're trying to show you here. It's kind of like jaggedy looking as they carve that out. And so the result is sort of a fuzzier look. It's not as hard edge of a line. So those are the first two types of intaglio method. And here is an example of each of them. Albert Dürer, very, very famous engraver. Night, Death, and the Devil. He was a Northern Renaissance artist as well. And if you can look at that and just look at the extreme detail of this, this was all done through that process of engraving, where he just cut with a with that burin tool, and then the ink goes into the crevices when he prints it. So that is, you can just see what extreme detail you can get with this intaglio method of engraving. And then the other one here, Mary Cassatt's The Caress, is done with dry point, a much simpler drawing, not as much detail, of course, but the texture of it, I think if you can look at the hair and just look at the lines that are created, these aren't as easy to see, but if you look at the hair especially, just look at the fuzziness of it. It's just got a softer, fuzzier feel to the line quality. Even though there's so much happening in this one, you do get a bit of a more crisp and sharp line quality in his work here with that engraving. Where remember the dry point, it sort of scruffs the surface of the cuts, and that results in a fuzzier look. The next one's called mezzotint. Mezzotint produces a subtle shade of gray or shades of gray. That's in italics, so I'm feeling that's important for something detail for you to remember. So a plate is first roughed by using a mezzotint. So take a look at this right here. This is the tool right there called a mezzotint rocker. And do you see how it's curved like that? It's like a, you can roll it back and forth. And so picture that metal plate from the video I showed you a bit ago. Same idea, you have a metal plate. But you have this rocker that's got all these little spiky things on it. And as you rock it across the surface right here, do you see how rough they're trying to show you that that is? And when you do that, it roughs up the surface and makes places where the ink is going to stick in those little crevices and nooks and crannies and things and textury stuff. The artist then works from dark to light by smoothing areas of the surface with a burnisher so they cannot hold ink. So it's kind of working backwards, right? Instead of starting with a smooth surface like these two and drawing into it, now you're starting with an overall rough textury surface, and then you're using this burnishing tool here to smooth out lines. You work from dark to light by smoothing them out. The whole thing's gonna look dark when you print it, once you've run this rocker over it, because it's all gonna pick up ink. But the more areas you smooth, the lighter it's going to get, because that's not going to pick up ink once you smooth the roughness back down. That's an interesting technique. Let's see what the example looks like for mezzotint. Here's an example. So if you can picture that in your mind, this whole thing, like he had a metal plate, he went over that whole part with a rocker, and it was all roughed up, textury and rough. Kind of like sandpaper, maybe not quite as rough as sandpaper, but that's kind of the idea. It's just all roughed up. And so wherever the black is that you see that printed, he left it rough. and then the ink gets picked up there. But wherever it's smooth, like on even the highlights on his jacket or the tones on his face, as it gets lighter and lighter, that's where the artists smooth out the texture. That's a lot of little marks and blending and kind of working that tool to get all this smooth, less rough, gradually less rough, clear to the point where like the shiny spot on his nose and his chin and right here, those would have been perfectly, totally smoothed out with that tool so that it doesn't pick up any ink. So it's really backwards and probably very time consuming. And the last two are called etching and aquatint. So etching is the one we just watched a video on. So that one should be pretty clear and understandable in your mind. And it's really, and aquatint's a variation of etching. So these two are really just like that video I showed you. And they're the most complex to understand. But as the video described, acids are used to bite lines into a metal plate. It requires the use of a ground to protect areas of the metal plate from acid. Do you remember that? They put that black stuff on first, then carved away lines, cut away lines from the ground, soaked it in acid, and the acid eats into the places where you removed the ground, the little lines, and then that's where the ink gets picked up. So again, here's the ground, cutting into the ground with lines, use acid, the acid eats down into the plate, and then you ink it up, and there you go. So aqua tint, is a variation of etching process. It allows for the development of flat tonal areas through special plate preparation with powdered resin. So it's very similar, except with this one, you kind of control the areas that are left with resin over them, and they're big areas or shapes more. Rather than lines, it's more like shapes are eaten away with the acid. So that's what aquatint is. The big difference is flat tonal areas. Write that down for aquatint. And that happens because of the special way you prepare the plate. They said powdered resin here, which is, I'm sure, what is technically used. But it's the same idea of that ground. Wherever you put the ground or the powdered resin, the acid can't eat into the surface of the plate. Okay, so I'll show you what these look like. Here's an example of etching. This is just like the one I showed you in the video as far as they put the ground, they cut into it with the little lines. Look how fuzzy it, but you can get very detailed. Look at those tiny lines that the artist is able to do. Very tiny details of line is very possible with many of these printmaking techniques. And then you remember how when I told you when it goes through the printing press, the paper is embossed because it presses that plate so hard onto the paper. Now there's aquatint, and I hope you can see the difference here. Look at, especially like this on the the donkey's pants, this whole kind of grayish shape. Do you see that? This whole area here? It's like one gray tone, aside from the black here. Don't look at the black tone. But this tone right here, it's all the same. And so that shows that they put the resin on there, but then they took the resin off and then soaked it in the acid, let it eat the acid away, let it eat the plate away a little bit, and then took it back out. And then they covered it with more resin, and then they soaked it in the ink again, or the acid again, and the acid ate the white part away even more to make sure that stays really light. So, actually I'm saying that whole thing backwards, I think. Wherever it's blacker is where it actually is going to be eaten out more. So this has been like, the metal plate has been corroded very deeply down into the metal plate, and then all that ink goes down into there. But the whole, like, do you see how it's like tonal areas, that, like shapes, shapes of white, shapes of gray, shapes of black, where here the dark and light is created through line work, isn't it? So that's really the big difference. But they're done the same way, same process, just line versus shape, really. Okay, then another technique we have is lithography. Lithography is a planographic process. The printing surface is flat, so we don't cut into the surface. We don't leave it raised like relief. We don't cut into it like intaglio. This is a whole different thing. It's actually left flat. It depends on the principle that oil and water do not mix. So I'm going to show you the, we'll go to this next, and then I'll go back and give you those bullets. So lithography. It is a pretty complex process, and you might ask yourself, why is the artist going to all this trouble to do all these steps just to create these images? But I think that there'll be one answer to that when we get to the end. First, look at this picture right here. This is an example of lithography. And then let's go ahead and look through the process. So here's the things that you need. This is a stone, we call it, a grinding stone that you will actually use as your matrix. Lithography is a planographic printmaking process in which the design is drawn on a flat stone, just like your note said, or prepared metal plate, so you could use metal, and affixed by means of a chemical reaction. First, the design is for the lithography, excuse me, the design for the lithograph is drawn directly onto a polished slab of limestone using an oil-based lithographic crayon or ink. So what you see here, this big thing right here, is a limestone slab. And from my experience in art school, you have to grind these slabs for a long time to get them perfectly smooth. The smoothness is very important for the success of the print. So there's these huge, like, grinding, sanding stone things that you just churn, or you roll them around and around and around, and you have to keep it wet, and you just grind and grind and grind and grind and grind to get it as smooth as you possibly can. But once it's smooth, then you draw on it with this wax crown, and that's important that it's wax. Once the design is complete, the stone is ready to be processed or etched. A layer of powdered rosin, is rubbed onto the stone, followed by a layer of powdered talc. So those are your first two steps. There's lots of materials in this one. So there's powdered rosin is rubbed onto it, then a layer of powdered talc. Gum arabic, or a combination of gum arabic with a mild acid solution, is then brushed onto the stone. The chemical reaction between the solution and the stone fixes the greasy image that is drawn with the oil-based lithographic crayon. So what we're trying to do is get that drawing that's on there. They're trying to get that to be fixed onto the stone. So it's like not going anywhere. It's fixed on there. At the same time, the solution ensures that the blank areas of the stone will absorb water and repel printing ink. So this stuff that he's putting on there now, the gum arabic mild acid solution, that will make the stone, this part of the stone, it will not accept ink. And that's important for printing the image. The original drawing is then wiped away with a solvent. So look, he just wiped it away. Known as lithotone, which leaves a ghost-like trace of the image on the stone. I told you there are lots of steps to this one. And you don't have to know these, by the way. You don't have to memorize these steps. This is just to give you a visual of how it works. To provide a base for inking, a layer of asphaltum is then buffed onto the entire surface of the stone and allowed to dry. So there's another layer of stuff. Before the stone is ready for inking, it is dampened with water, which is absorbed only in the blank areas. Do you see that? It's only absorbed in the, see when he wipes that? Do you see how the design is resisting the water? Ink is then applied to the stone with a roller. The oil-based ink adheres to the greasy area of the image and is repelled by the damp parts of the stone. The dampening and inking of the stone is repeated until the entire image is thoroughly inked. The stone is placed with the image facing up on a flatbed lithographic press, and a damp sheet of paper is laid on top. The stone and paper are covered with a board, also called a time pan, and sometimes several sheets of newsprint as padded for the press. A flatbed press is equipped with a pressure bar. This bar, which usually approximates the size of the image, is lowered onto the time pan and the stone, and is dragged across the greased surface as it passes through the press. The bar guarantees a smooth and even application of pressure across the surface of the stone. Once the stone has been run through the press, the resulting impression on paper displays a reverse image of the original composition drawn onto the stone. Now, that is quite a process, is it not? That is an incredibly complicated process. And the little note down here at the end says, if you want to have multiple colors, you have to have additional stones for each desired color. And then you have to make sure that they get lined up properly. Do you remember what that's called when you line them up? It's called registration. And here it is. It says, care must be taken to precisely register or align the stone each time. So you might be thinking, why in the world would you do this complicated process? Obviously, that is time consuming, right? But do you remember the very beginning? Oops, this part? Do you see how freely that artist is able to just draw and sketch and create their image? It's very open to however you want to draw with the grease crayon. And so I think that is definitely the big reason why this type of printmaking is different than the other ones. The other ones require a very challenging tool to make the image with, and this allows a lot more freedom and just expressive drawing. This is like drawing skill, right? Just drawing freely and expressing yourself. So I think that's the thing that makes this a little more appealing to some people that just want to create in that sort of fashion, very loose and free form. And so then look again at this one. It definitely, so there's multiple colors here, first of all, so that would be like four stones, because I see peach, green, yellow, which is probably just a mixture of that tan and peach together, maybe, and then black, and then this gray. So that's probably four different stones to create that lithograph. It is very time consuming and intense, I think, for a printmaking process, but pretty neat too. So let me go back through these bullets now that we've seen that whole process. The artist draws on a stone or plate using a greasy pencil or touche, which is a greasy ink. The surface is treated with a series of chemical etches that establish grease accepting and water accepting areas. That right there is the whole process. When all those different layers of powder and talc and whatever they put on it, all those different things, a little bit of acid somewhere in there, right? Those are all just to create some areas that accept water and some that make grease accepting. So it's really all just like knowing the chemical reactions. The surface is rolled with ink while damp and run through a press. And here's our one example of the lithography that you can see finished. They have a very just normal drawing appearance, right? They just look like they could have been done with pencil. And again, the really special thing about printmaking is you can make as many of these as you want to. Once you have that stone ready to go, you can just keep repeating those prints. And so that's really the magic of printmaking. It's not just one. Okay, screen printing is based on the use of stencils. Silk screen or serography, make sure you get those two terms down as well, are basically the same thing, and they mean silk writing. Those are other terms used to describe this process. So it's kind of a process that has lots of names, doesn't it? Screen printing, silk screen, serography, they're all basically silk writing. And we'll go back to the Met, and we will look at screen printing. I think it's helpful to see real examples. So here's some of the tools that you use for screen printing. You've got different colored inks. You've got your squeegees, which is just what it sounds like. It's a thing you hold on to, and then right here is a squeegee rubber edge, just like when you squeegee a mirror or glass or something. And here is your screen for screen printing. This is extremely fine mesh over this. You can't even see because it's so, you can't even see the texture of it. Screen printing is a process where ink is forced through a mesh screen onto a surface. Making certain areas of the screen impervious to printing, ink creates a stencil, basically, which blocks the printing ink from passing through the screen. The ink that passes through forms the printed image. A printing screen consists of a fine mesh fabric. That's what's yellow in this picture right here, this fine mesh fabric, that is tightly stretched and attached to a metal or wooden frame. Traditionally, these screens were made of silk, hence the name silkscreen, but today they are most often made of synthetic materials such as terralene. Stencils, which can be composed of a wide variety of materials, including fabric, greasy paint, or a design on a transparency, can be added to the screen in different ways. Placing them directly onto the surface of the screen, painting them onto the screen, or by transferring a design onto the screen using photosensitive emulsion. Now, most people, not a lot of people have this photosensitive emulsion process. It's going to show you what that looks like. It's a little fancier than a lot of screen printers would have in their own personal use. But regardless, there's different ways. You got to get that stencil or that image transferred onto the screen. The transfer of a design on transparency or mylar film onto photosensitive emulsion is the most common contemporary method to prepare a screen. Designs can be made by any or a combination of the following ways. Hand-drawn with an opaque ink or printed on to the transparency or cut out of rubylith, an ultraviolet masking film. To transfer the design from the transparency, the screen is first coated with a thin layer of photosensitive emulsion using a scoop coater, a metal trough that has a clean, even edge. So you see what she's doing? She's just smushing that photosensitive emulsion to coat the entire screen. After the emulsion dries, the design is placed against the screen. So she's doing all those designs on that transparency paper. Now remember, this is photosensitive, so it's going to do something when they use ultraviolet light. The screen is then placed in an exposure unit. This is what I said. They said is very common for mass production like this, but a small town person, small time person wouldn't have something like that. It emits ultraviolet light. When the exposure unit is on, the design blocks the UV light that hardens the emulsion around the image. And you'll see the result here. The emulsion covered by the design remains soft. So where the design was, it doesn't let the emulsion harden there. And so now she's hosing it down and that comes off. Wherever the emulsion was not, gets washed away. Wherever it wasn't allowed to harden. Because the little stencil things, as you recall, that are on there, those blocked the light. So it's not really about blocking the substance, it's blocking the light, which then didn't allow the UV rays to go through. Once the screen has been prepared, it's placed on hinges affixed to a board or screen printing table, which has hinges at the top and holes at the in the surface that allow a vacuum to hold a sheet of paper in place during printing. A thick bead of ink is applied along the top of the inside of the screen and then pulled evenly across the image, that pink ink that she's doing right now. Using a squeegee, that's what she's using, an action known as flooding the screen. A sheet of paper is then placed under the screen, and with another pass of the squeegee, the ink is pushed through those areas of the screen that are not blocked by the stencil, and the resulting impression follows the direction of the matrix. And so what do we get at the end? The composition requires, if it requires more than one color, of course, you have to repeat the process using different stencils for each color. And again, you have to ensure proper registration. You have to make sure they're aligned properly. Okay, so that's screen printing in a nutshell. And these bullets here kind of review that again for you. A screen made of fine mesh is mounted on a frame. The artist blocks out areas not meant to print using stencils or special glues. And yes, the more old-fashioned primitive way of the traditional way is to use special glues and like block it out. We just call it block, and it blocks out areas you don't want to print. That printer thing and the emulsion stuff is a little fancier. A squeegee is used to force ink onto a printing surface. Okay, and so this is our example of a screen print called Standard Station 1966. And you can see there's multiple colors in this, obviously, so he would have had to do several screens, choosing each time what do you block out, what do you not block out, and then also to create that sunset effect in the background, he would have had to do like a blending of the colors for that one when he did that layer. So all the different parts that you see are kind of done in layers, you can think of it. But you have to really understand your image and understand the graphics of it. Like, what are you blocking out? It'd be very easy to mess up, especially on these, like, little things here, and to forget what was supposed to be blocked out and block out the wrong thing or not enough, and then you accidentally ink over something that you wanted to not be inked. So that takes a lot of skill, too. Screen printing is not going to be something you can just jump into and do the first time. It takes quite a bit of skill. Okay, and this type of printmaking is called monotype. It is a different, completely different, and a special one for you to remember, and I hope you can understand why pretty quickly here. A monotype consists of a single print. The artist typically applies diluted paint to a metal or non-absorbent surface, places paper over the image, and runs it through a press. Here's the big key. Everybody put stars and whistles around this one. Only one print can be made. So this is breaking the rules of printmaking, right? That's the whole big, beautiful thing about printmaking is you can make multiple types. You can make an addition. You can make several prints, but not with mono print. Do you hear the word mono print? Has the word mono in it? Mono means one, okay? So here's this kind of strange picture of a man with his bird, I guess. And this was done one time. You would use like a plate, a lot of times artists will use just like a plexiglass plate. They will use inks and they will draw the image onto the plate, and then you simply print it. You do the same thing. You put a piece of paper over it. You run it through a printing press, comes out the other side, but guess what? That's the only one there will ever be. You can't repeat it because the ink has been placed down and then it's printed, and that's all there is. So it is a bit different. There's not a matrix that stays with monoprint. And then lastly, we have inkjet. An inkjet print consists of an image created using a digital file. A high-quality printer sprays mists of ink onto typically a paper surface to create the image. Everybody got that one down. And so I don't have an image of that because we're all familiar with that. We know what digital inkjets do. It's using the data from your computer and telling it what to spray out and what to not. And so then those droplets of ink go onto the paper. And obviously you can print that as many times as you want to. And that's digital inkjet printing. And so that is our final slide. Printmaking is quite a complex thing, and there are many things that you have learned today about that process, and hopefully taken some good notes over it. We have, this was chapter 8, and so chapter 9 will be photography and film, and that will be our last section for this grouping of chapters. So that was 6, 7, 8, and 9. And then you'll have a test over those. So just to kind of give you a little heads up on how that is laid out. I hope you have a great day.